Hebrews chapter 9 in verse 24. Hebrews chapter 9 in verse 24, the Bible says, "For Christ has not entered into the holy places made with hands, which are the figures of the true, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for us. Nor yet that he should offer himself often, as high priest entereth into the holy place every year with blood of others, for then he must often have suffered since the foundation of the world. But now, once in the end of the world, hath he appeared to put sin away by the sacrifice of himself. And as it is appointed unto man once to die, but after this, judgment. So Christ once offered to bear the sins of many, and unto them that look for him shall he appear the second time without sin unto salvation." I'd like to preach this evening, the Lord being my helper on the thought, getting comfortable with death. Dear Lord, we thank you for your blessings, Lord. We thank you for your goodness. Lord, we thank you for your word that lays here before us. And we praise you and thank you that it's been preserved down through the ages, even for tonight, Lord. We praise you for that. Lord, we pray that you would be with the people that sit before us this evening. We certainly know by your own word that nobody's here by accident, but rather by divine act. And we know that they're here for a reason, Lord, and we pray that you would speak to them. Lord, the lost that meet among us, we pray that you would save them even tonight, Lord, that you would bring life their way, because we know it only comes from you. God, help us as a people, help us as a church, that we might be bound together in a day that seems very dark. Lord, we pray that you would give us strength, give us guidance as we try to preach. And we pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Now, fairly familiar verses of Scripture. I personally believe that Paul is the writer to the book of Hebrews. That information is never given us definitively in the Word of God, but I believe Paul was writing back to the church at Jerusalem. In one place, Paul says that Peter, "I withstood him to his face." And the reason that Paul withstood Peter to his face is that he was adding works back to salvation. And, you know, there's a lot of that wannabe Jew stuff going on today. And it don't disturb me too much, because it's always been. Now, the blessed truth is this: the Jewish was God's chosen people, but we're not Jewish, we're Christian. And there is a difference. And so I personally believe Paul was rebuking the church in Jerusalem because they had entered back into some types of work, not because of salvation, but for it. In verse 24, he says, "For Christ has not entered into the holy places made with hands." Now, we know that the way the Jewish temple was set up here on earth, that the holies of holies was at the rear of the temple and also at the rear of the tabernacle. And they'd go in there one time a year and offer a blood sacrifice on the mercy seat to roll back the sin of Israel for 1 year. And then the next year it had to be done again, and the year after that it had to be done again. Now, they understood this principle, this Jewish church, and he says, listen, that was just a type. And, you know, the Lord Jesus truly went in and performed this miracle and offered the mercy seat. The offering on the mercy seat in the holies of holies. He said, the one you had down here is just a picture of the one in glory. It was a real, real place in the divine glory, and it had to be offered just as it did here. And the Lord Jesus was the only one worthy to do that. Amen. Now, if you remember following the resurrection and he saw Mary at the tomb, what did he say to her? He said, "Touch me not, Mary, for I'm not yet ascended unto the Father." See, he still had that job to do, and the sacrifice couldn't be contaminated. And so he says, "Don't you touch me yet. I have to go to the Father." And so, as Paul is writing to the church there at Jerusalem, he's dealing with them some very Jewish terms because they understood Jewish doctrine. He says that was just a type. Verse 24, "Nor yet that he should offer himself often." Now, if you write in your Bible, you know verse 25 because you have people trying today to be saved and re-saved and saved again and saved another day. No, no. It is a one-time event, and anything else puts the Lord to an open shame.
Amen. Yeah.
And so, we see here, he's very clear. He said he went one time into the holy place. Mm-hmm. Now, one point of contention people don't like, but I want you to see in the following verse, it doesn't say all. You know what? The Lord Jesus Christ did not die for everybody, because if he did, his blood was wasted in vain. For those that are never redeemed, listen, that'd be a wasteful thing. Could you imagine wasting the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ?
Amen.
And you see here that it says very, you know, talking about Jewish sacrifice, you know, that was for 1 year. For one group of people, the living Jews at that time. Mm-hmm. You know what that is? That's particular. That's specific, isn't it? Mm-hmm. And he says the Lord Jesus Christ did the same thing. Now, drop down there, if you don't understand that, drop down there to verse 28. It says, so Christ once offered himself to bear the sins of what? Many. Mm-hmm. Not all. He did it for many. See, this is the crux of the whole matter. If Christ could set out to save everyone, you know what? Everyone would be saved, because Christ is not a failure. He's never been a failure. He's accomplished everything that he always wanted to do. And so I want you to see that he's very specific and very particular with his people. Now, that was all just extra, because I want you to really look at verse 27. Here it says, and speaking of Christ's death and our death too, as it is appointed unto man once to die, but after this, the judgment. You know what? You are appointed to die. The day you were born, I was born just 10 miles south of here in Carlisle, Tennessee, at my great-grandmother's home. And at that point, on December the 19th, 1968, you know what? At that very time, my appointment was done set.
Right.
And you know, when it comes up, I don't know how long it'll be. It'll be 49 years since that day. But you know what? Whenever that appointment comes, I'm not getting out of it. There's no excuse me. There's no respond very promptly. So I'm not going to be able to make it. It's going to happen.
Yes, amen.
And you know what? People don't like. You know what I found about people are not really comfortable with death.
No.
People that claim to be believers are not really comfortable to death.
Amen.
And you know what? It'll end up testing you of really where you're at. So, if it's a news broadcast to you tonight, you're already on your way out. You're already in an active dying. You're already, just as sure as you were born, your death time is coming. And Paul makes it very clear to him, it is appointed unto man once to die, but after that, the judgment. Now, we're going to look at some individuals tonight that thought they could get around that, or thought that they could prolong that they could avoid it. But listen, death is not to be avoided. You have to deal with it. Now, this is the thing with dealing with death. You have to come to terms, one or two things. This is not all there is to it, meaning this little expanse of time that we have. Or you've got to face an almighty God. You know, really, sometimes I don't think it's the death thing that bothers people rather than being subject unto an almighty God. To step from this life into next and be before the Creator of all the universe. And knowing then that you're going to hear, depart from me, you worker of iniquity. You know, when the Lord give that teaching, you know what the next verse says? Depart from me, you worker of iniquity. For I never knew you.
That's right. They never.
Yeah.
Not that I knew you and I quit knowing you. I never knew you. Now, if we have an all-living, all-knowing, all-understanding God, He did know they exist. You know what? The Lord God of heaven knows Lucifer exists. But is Lucifer, is the devil himself, is he a saved entity? No. In fact, it's an abomination. He hates God and God hates him. And yes, our God is capable of a perfect hate. He does not love Lucifer. Our God hates him with a perfect hate. He knew about him, but he didn't know him in salvation. He didn't know him in redemption. And if you're lost this evening, he knows about you. He knows who you are. He knows what you're up to. He knows all everything there is to know about you. So when you begin to think about death, and we should consider death, we should consider the finality of this life, how quickly it comes and goes and it's gone. And you know what? We squander most of that precious time on things, pursuits that mean next to nothing.
Amen. That's right.
And then we wake up and we're old and we realize that our bodies infirm now. And the very best years of our life, we wasted on things that mean nothing.
Amen.
I'll tell you what, while you have your youth, use it for the Lord. That's why Solomon, Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 4 says, "Remember thy Creator in the days of thy youth, when the hard time cometh not." Because see, he'd learned that was the time to use for God. And I think Solomon, like us, learned a little bit too late. Go with me to the book of 1 Kings. 1 Kings chapter 22. 1 Kings chapter 22. And we're going to begin reading in verse 29. 1 Kings chapter 22, beginning in verse 29. So the king of Israel and Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, went up to Ramoth Gilead. And the king of Israel said unto Jehoshaphat, "I will disguise myself and enter into the battle, but put thou on my robes." And the king of Israel disguised himself and went into the battle. Now, I want you to get the full picture here that at this point, the kingdom of Israel was divided into the northern and the southern kingdoms, and you had Judah and you had Israel, but at this time they were kind of at a truce, and they were fighting a common enemy, the Syrians. And they said, "Let's trade places. Let's fool the enemy. They'll think I'm you, and they'll think you're me, and we'll get one over on them." You know what? That never works. You will not one up God ever. You know what? As much as you would like to think you are, you're not in control of your health. Now, there's no need to be foolhardy with it. I believe the body's given to us, the Bible says, is a temple. And it should be taken care of, just as such. But on the flip side, you know what? You're not going to change the plan of God. You're not going to thwart the plan of God. It's an impossibility. And these men thought they were going to pull one over. They were going to pull one over on the Syrian army. They were going to trick. But notice what was happening. Verse 31. But the king of Syria commanded his 32 captains that had rule over his chariot, saying, "Fight neither with the small nor the great, save only with the king of Israel." Now, I want you to see that they had these huge battalions of men, and he says, "I want one guy. I want the king of Israel. That's the one you're to put your whole focus on. That's the one you're to put your whole emphasis on. I want to take him down." And that was the enemy's plan. And I'll tell you this tonight, really the enemy's plan for you is to take you down. And to take you down while you're young. And to take you down and give you those little feelings of discontent. And to give you those little ideas that there's something better out there. And give you those little ideas that, oh, mom and daddy don't know what they're talking about. That's what Satan breeds. But let me tell you this, you'll wake up one day far, far from home. Remember the rich young ruler? Down there feeding hogs.
Yeah.
Richest boy on the block, and now he's down there with nothing. The Bible said when he came to himself. See, you'd be a lot better off never to have that trip.
Yeah.
You'd be a lot better off just to stay with the Lord. And so we see that they had this plan, but Syria was going to come after them, and the enemy did come down on them, verse 32. And it came to pass, when the captains of the chariot saw Jehoshaphat, that they said, surely this is the king of Israel. Now the reason they thought that is because he had the king of Israel garment on instead of the king of Judah's garment on. And they turned aside to fight against him, and Jehoshaphat cried out. Now, what he cried out is, listen, it's not me. I'm not the king of Israel. I have on his robe and I have on his garments, but listen, it's not me. I'm Jehoshaphat. I'm the king of Judah. You leave me alone. You know what? Be careful who you trust.
Yeah.
He picked him out, didn't he? And you know what? You would have too. You're looking down the wrong end of the spear, you say a lot of things. And so we see that despite the deception, death did catch up with them. Now notice in verse 33, and it came to pass when the captains of the chariots, this is verse 32, saw Jehoshaphat, they said, surely this is the king of Israel, and they turned aside to fight against him, and Jehoshaphat cried out. And it came to pass when the captains of the chariots perceived that it was not the king of Israel, they turned back from pursuing him. They didn't have the right guy. Verse 34, and a certain man drew a bow at venture, meaning just perchance, just on a whim, and smote the king of Israel between the joints of his harness.
Yeah.
Now, I'll tell you how specific. You talk about not getting away from God. Just an everyday soldier, just shooting one, just shooting it out there. Comes down and strikes him between the shoulder dress and the breastplate of his uniform. See, God will put it where it needs to be. You won't get away from it. You say, well, that's pretty grim, but I'm just telling you the truth. Death is a reality that you better deal with. And you know what? You need to deal with it now. You need to deal with it while you're young. While there's time for planning. While there's time, while you're on this side of eternity, understand the reality of death. And listen, the only thing that passes death is the Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 35. And behold, the battle increased, and the day was stayed up and the king was stayed up in his chariot against the Syrians, and died even. And the blood ran out of the wound into the midst of the chariot, and there was there went out a proclamation throughout the host about the going down of the sun, saying, every man to his city, and every man to his country. So the king died and was brought to Samaria, and they buried the king in Samaria. Now I want you to notice two things. He did not avoid death. The death was delivered, just as God knew it would be. And he was buried down at the enemy's camp. You know, I've often wondered how many people has been buried at the enemy's camp.
Yeah.
You know, first of all, I'll say this. You don't ever know about anybody but yourself. And on some days, I wonder about me. That makes sense? And I mean your soul condition. But I've seen a lot of people claim to be redeemed and live like dogs their whole life. Really, I don't have much confidence in them. But I will say this, if they are redeemed, they were buried down in Syria. They were buried in the enemy's camp. They were buried in the wrong place. And the reason they were buried in the wrong place is, listen, they died in the wrong place.
Yeah.
Many times, you don't know. You think when he got up that morning, that he planned, hey, this is going to be my last day. I'm going to spend it down at the battle. You know, most people don't think that way. If I knew I had one day to live, I'd want it with my children and grandchildren. And you know, I ain't that much different than anybody. anybody else. I don't think he would have wasted his time in a needless pursuit if he knew it was the last day. So I ask you, if this was your last day, what would you do? Now, if you have any spiritual sense at all, one thing I would like to do is spend some meaningful time in prayer on my last day, going before God and putting my family before Him, looking forward to the day to go to be with Him. How are you going to spend your last day? I think we need to answer that, don't you? And the reason why, it may be today. It may be tomorrow. See, we all think we have more time, don't we? And you know what? What I have found is you move the steps up. My boys are always teasing me, especially Matthew. He and I have had a discussion for about 10 years about me being middle-aged. And I emphatically denied that I was middle-aged. But now I have to admit, if I'm just now middle-aged, I'll have to live to be 98. To be middle-aged right now, right? So I have to say, yeah, I'm past middle age. And, you know, that's not a real pleasant feeling. And you know what? When you begin to think about it like this, and say middle age is 40, and most people say it's a little less than that, but just say it's 40. Justin's probably one of the younger fellows in here. 22 years, you'll be halfway there. Right? Mm-hmm. And you say, oh, that's forever, Brother Larry. Well, you just wait.
Yeah.
And it'll go by before you know it. So our days are precious, and we need to use them just as so. You're not going to miss that appointment. 2 Kings chapter 20. 2 Kings chapter 20, in the very first verse, the Bible says, "And in those days was Hezekiah sick unto death, and the prophet Isaiah, the son of Amos," the book that Isaiah wrote, this is the prophet that recorded it, "and the prophet Isaiah, the son of Amos, came to him and said unto him, Thus saith the Lord, set thine house in order, for thou shalt die and not live." You know what? That is true for every one of us tonight. Set thine house in order, because you're not going to make it. I'm not going to make it. You're not going to make it. You're not going to make it. Ain't not one of us under the sound of my voice going to live here forever. So the best advice I can give you is set your house in order. And the only thing that you got is your never-dying soul. That is the only thing you have. It's the only thing you brought into this earth, and it's the only thing that you'll take out. Now, you rest assured, you're going to live on and on somewhere.
That's right.
Amen.
This soul, the only thing about what you see this evening that's indestructible is my inner soul. And it will go on and on and on and on and on somewhere. Now, blessed be the name of the Lord. I'm going to be at the feet of Jesus.
Amen.
I'm going to be there, and I'm going to give Him praises and glory for the everlasting ages. What about you? Listen, you know, this is the thing. And listen, if you don't sometimes doubt your relationship with Christ, you could be lost. Because you know what the Bible tells us to do? Make your calling and election sure. That means you sit around and study about it. You pray about it sometimes. You think back on the day that you met Christ. That's making your calling and election sure. But you know what? The older I get, the more comfortable I am with just going home to the Lord. I'm okay with that. That's setting your house in order. That's making sure everything's okay. You know, a lot of times when you think about setting a house in order is being sure that your wife and your youngins are going to be taken care of. Now, men, that is our responsibility. But at the same time, that's not setting your house in order. Money comes and goes. Now, verse 2 says, "Then he turned his face to the wall and prayed unto the Lord, saying, I beseech thee, O Lord, remember now how I have walked before thee in truth and with a perfect heart, and have done that which is good in thy sight. And Hezekiah wept sore. Now, a couple of different ways you can think about it. Number one, Hezekiah was made out of the same stuff you and I are made out of. And he wasn't going, "Woo! I'm going to get to die." Says that he wept sore. He began to recall some things in his life and said, "Have I not walked before thee?" And you know, every one of these statements that Hezekiah made was right on. He was a godly man. He was a godly king when there wasn't one. But you know what? He still died. And you know what? This is the truth too. God's plan is always best. Now, can you thwart the plan of God? No. That means you're going to change it or you're going to stop it. That is an impossibility for human beings. Now, we don't like to be down there where we can't, but that's where we're at. You can't change the plan of God. But I will tell you this, and it's a miserable condition. You can live in the permissive will of God instead of the perfect will of God. And for the next 15 years, I think that's exactly what Hezekiah did.
Yeah.
Because he said, even before Isaiah got out of the temple, he says, "Go back, tell Hezekiah that I'm going to give him 5 more years." And he did. And he raised up, and he was whole again. But the problem, 15 years later, when he did die, the most ungodly king that ever lived took the throne. And you know what? He was born in that little 15-year window. He was 12 years old when he took the throne. See, wouldn't it have been better to go with God's plan? And you never would have seen Jeroboam. He would have never existed. He'd never been part. But you know what? Sometimes we get what we pray for. And it ain't just what we thought it was going to be, is it? It ain't going to be just as good. Woo, this is great. Sometimes it's a little bit of grit to go with that. You know what the Lord Jesus said about praying? He said, "You don't even know what to pray for." He says, "You ought not to pray for." You know what a prayer should sound like? "Blessed be the name of the Father. Great and glorious and mighty is your ways. High and lifted up be you forever and ever and ever and ever. And if you can keep from it, not ask for one stinking thing."
Amen.
Just praise and adoration. Because you know what he said? "Take your food. With food and raiment, be there with content." Now before last, it rained like a monsoon at Bunk's Mill. You know what I had above me? A good old tight roof. Me and the youngins and Donna just sitting there didn't have no promise at all. That's a lot more than he promised, ain't it? A lot more than he promised. And so we as the Lord's people are not going to avoid death. Death is a reality. Death will happen. And many times it should be just something that is accepted. That we receive knowingly that God knows best. Go with me to the book of 1 Corinthians. We'll bring it down to the modern age. 1 Corinthians chapter number 15. 1 Corinthians 15, and we're going to begin reading in verse 55. 1 Corinthians 15. Verse 55, Paul writing to the church at Corinth, church that was full of sin, that had things out of order, that weren't doing what the Lord had told them to do, that had a man running with his stepmother right there in the church and they were defending it. That type of church, as he's closing out his letter, Paul says, "O death, where is thy sting?" You know what? Whether we want to admit it or not, and we put the B in Baptist, there is a sting of death.
Yeah.
You know what? Every time I make this little trip right through here and get to this pew, you know who I think of? That's where my sister and my brother-in-law sit.
A lot of you don't remember it because it's been so long, but every time I look there, I think about Judy. You know what? That stunk. 44-year-old woman wiped out of here in 10 months. From the day she was diagnosed to the day she died. 10 months. That stinks. And you and I both would be lying if we say that it didn't. But you know where the sting is at? It's in this old flesh. Mm-hmm. That's what the sting is.
Right.
Dorothy's been gone 7-8 years. Mm-hmm. I still miss her. She was a card. The sting, you know, they're better off. The sting is us. You know, I'm not afraid of death, and I can say that truly. But sometimes, seeing the way that Judy went, I dread it. If I could just get hit by a truck or something, I'd be okay with that. But you know what? I may linger for a year or two, or three, or four. That's a sting, is it not? I'm a big baby. Donna says male nurses are pretty bad patients. I don't want to lay around hurt. I mean, really, nobody does. That's a sting, is it not? So where is the sting of death? Paul is asking that as a real question. It's in the flesh, and it's for those of us who are left behind. It's not. If you're redeemed, listen, once it's done, and you're in glory. Right? Now, if you don't know the Lord, listen, the sting has just begun. You talk about that suffering here in the flesh is nothing compared to being thrown alive into the lake of fire. There's nothing to compare to that. And so we see that Paul asks a very true question. Verse 55, O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? You know what? It doesn't have a victory for the redeemed. Now, it does have a victory for the lost. That's why I'm telling you tonight, you be sure that you're sure. Listen, if you're lost, I hope it tears you up. I hope you don't even sleep a wink tonight. I hope you're so troubled that you can't even rest. Because I want you to know this, you are going to die. And after you die, you're going to stand in front of a righteous judgment.
Amen. That's it.
Seek the Lord while He may be found. You seek Him. You get in that book. You go from cover to cover. You pray and you don't let up until you come back with something real. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin.
Right.
See, Adam got stung in the garden.
Mm-hmm.
And has been stinging us ever since. Methuselah, oldest man that ever lived. 969 years. You can read that and it says, Methuselah lived 969 years and he died.
That's right.
969 years is a long, long, long time. But you know what? He died. You know, very few people that escape that sentence in the Bible. Enoch walked with God, and if he was not, for the Lord took him. There's one. Elijah went up by a whirlwind. Think about the ones the Lord Jesus raised from the dead. You want to know what? They died again. Eventually, Lazarus faced death. Eventually, the young man from Nain, he died. They're on the way to the graveyard with him. He raised up, no doubt he provided a living for his widowed mother for the years of her life. Then she died, then he died. Listen, that's just how it is. But you know what? What a wonderful, gracious Redeemer we have. He rose victorious. He put death and hell aside for you and I. The question is, do you know it? Listen, nothing could be more important than asking within yourself, do I really know Jesus? I'm not talking about some kind of foolish little prayer that somebody gets you to recite. Problem with that, it's not in the Bible. That's the first problem. Second is, it doesn't give any room whatsoever for God to do His miraculous work. If all we have to do is accept a set of given facts, where's God in that? But has He spoke life to you? That's really redemption. Remember Mary down at the temple? I mean, down at the grave. What did it say concerning Jesus? She thought He was the gardener. Then He said, Mary. An effectual call. She turned around and said, My Lord and my God. She knew Him then, didn't she? So the question is really this. Has He spoke life to you? You seek Him with everything you've got. Nothing in this world could make any difference at all.